That should be better. Really good to see you today. Welcome to our Cafe Carols on Friday. We've got another one on Sunday as well. But really good to see you. I hope you've got a drink and that you're eating mince pies and all that. And I think there's enough of drinks up there. So if you want to get a drink at any point, you can go and help yourselves. That's fine. Just relax. That's the idea. So we want it to be a relaxed time. We're going to have some music. Some of it's going to be on the screen. Some of it's going to be live. Some of it, it's going to be readings. There's going to be something about the Christmas story as well. So lots of things to think about and to enjoy. Now, the only thing to say with the music is, so whenever the music group sort of do something, that's the chance for everybody to sing together. So if you want to sing some carols, stand up, and it's better if you stand up, and it'd be good if you could do that, but if you really don't want to, you don't have to, but stand up and we can all sing together some of the old favourite Christmas carols. And so that's the cue. So if they stand up, then that's the time to get ready to do some singing, okay, if you want to do that. One thing I want you to do is to look out for something, okay, or listen out for something, because at this time of year, so we've got like lights and all that kind of thing, and Christmas is all about lights very often, isn't it? And there's, you know, lights here and it's dark. This time of year for us is Christmas is really dark. If you live in Australia, it probably isn't, is it? Or Antarctica or something. But Christmas here is dark. And we love seeing lights, don't we? And the interesting thing is, if you listen to the words of the songs and the readings, try and spot where it talks about dark and light. Try and spot some of the things it says, because it's interesting. There's a lot of it in the Christmas story, and a bit later on we'll be thinking about some of that. So do listen out for that as we start. But we're going to start off straight away with a reading from the story from the Bible.
This is Luke 1:26-38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One is to be... The Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
The angel Gabriel from heaven came, his wings as drifted snow, his eyes as flame. "All hail," said he, "the lowly maiden Mary, most highly favored lady, shall be Emmanuel, I see his form. highly favor me, glory. Gentle Mary meekly bowed her head to me, be as it pleaseth God, she said. My soul shall loud and magnify his holy name, most highly favored lady, glory.
Second reading is from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
Well, the cue was the musicians standing up, but they didn't stand up, so now I'm going to tell them. So you can stand up and sing if you want to.
Oh, Story, but we're going outdoors now. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flock at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared, with angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Well, we're going to sing again now, and just to sort of trick you, the first verse of this one, we're going to just have male voices. We thought we'd try that, okay? It might not work, but if it doesn't, there's always verse two, so we'll give that a go.
Okay.
Do sit down.
Next reading is from John 1:1-14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Well, a couple of weeks ago, we were at home, we were watching a film, we were watching this, one of the Avengers films, and which is like a superhero film, if you haven't seen that, Marvel, I think it is, isn't it? And it was Avengers Age of Ultron, and there was this character, you can see it on the screen, this character Ultron is like this robot, artificial intelligence kind of computer robot, and this Ultron comes to the conclusion that the best thing for the world would be for humanity to be wiped off the planet. And basically Ultron, he's got all these kind of other robots that he's kind of made as well, and they've got this plan, and it looks as though they're gonna succeed. But imagine that, you know, so he thinks that the world would be better off without human beings. And actually it's interesting, because that idea crops up in quite a lot of films like this, although some of it from a bit further back, Terminator and iRobot, in all of those, there's like computers that think humans should be wiped off the planet. Now, why is that? Why do kind of the people who write films, scripts and that, kind of come up with these ideas? Why is there this idea that, you know, maybe the human beings would be better wiped off the planet? I wonder what you think about that. I guess all of us have got a vested interest in saying, actually, I think it'd be better if human beings weren't wiped off the planet. But of course, in films, in those films, that idea doesn't win. So in that film, there's this other character, Vision, who's also a kind of robot figure as well. And he tells Ultron, he said, you've got it wrong. He said, there's grace in their failings. I think you missed that. And Ultron says, they're doomed. But Vision says, yes, but a thing isn't beautiful because it lasts. It's a privilege to be among them. So it kind of rolls back from that in the end. But those stories are there, and I wonder why we come up with those kind of stories. But what about Christmas? What is Christmas, the story of Christmas, what is it all about? You know, and what is it saying to us? Does it have something to say about this sort of thing? And I think it does. And just in a few minutes, I wanted to try and sort of see what Christmas might have to do with all of that, because you might think it's a bit of a stretch. But I said at the beginning, could you spot anything to do with darkness and light in those readings and songs? I don't know if you did. There's quite a lot, actually. And there's quite a lot about night, obviously, because there's stuff happening at night. and all of that kind of thing. But also it does talk about darkness and about the light shining into that. And in fact, there were some words in that last reading where it said, the light shines in the darkness. And that's actually Christmas. That's what he's talking about. So he's describing there, it's this strange kind of, almost what it is, a kind of poetry, but he's describing reality. And he's talking about this person called the Word. But he says there, the light shines in the darkness. And that's Christmas. But what's it all about? And that's what I want to just quickly explain, because I think if we understand this, then we can really make sense of what Christmas is all about. And the first thing, so there's two things to kind of work out. What does it mean by darkness, and what does it mean by light? And so first of all, what does it mean by darkness? And on this, we need to be pretty straight, because the truth of the matter is the Bible's telling us that by darkness, it's talking about evil, badness. So there's this guy in the Bible called Job, and he went through some really dark stuff and had an incredibly tough time. And he said at one point, he said, yet when I hoped for good, evil came. When I looked for light, then came darkness. And he's kind of paralleling those things. He's saying there's good and there's evil, and there's light and there's dark, you see? So when the Bible talks about darkness, very often it's talking about evil. And the thing is, and this is the really difficult bit, that when it's talking about darkness, it's not just out there, it's talking about all of us. And it's talking about darkness as our problem as human beings. And it's rooted in the fact that we're not who we should be. We're not the people we should be. We've done wrong and we carry on doing it, even though we very often wish we wouldn't. And another place in the Bible, it says this, he says, there's no one righteous, in other words, good, not even one. There's no one who understands. There's no one who seeks God. All have turned away. And it's saying, although, you know, there might be some good, but actually there's this pattern. You know, we're all just doing our own thing. We're all turning away from God and not living lives that are anything like what he would have us do. And it's saying that's darkness. And it's pretty bleak, but it is talking about us. And I think if we're honest, most of us, if we kind of look deep inside, we'd admit that, you know, in me, I can see it. You know, there's badness there. There's hatred at times. There's lies. There's selfishness. And it boils up. And sometimes we don't even know where it came from. But we can see it inside us. There was this guy whose name is pretty difficult to read. But it's Alexander Solzhenitsyn, I think. I might have got it wrong. But let's go with that, okay? Solzhenitsyn. And he really suffered. He was put in a gulag. The Soviets put him in a gulag. It was like a prison. It was really terrible. And he said this. He said, the line between good and evil passes not through states, not between classes, not between political parties either, but right through the middle of every human heart and through all human hearts. In other words, he's saying, you know, much as he'd love to blame, you know, the people who put him in prison, actually he's admitting, he's saying, you know, the truth of the matter is, I realise that line is... it is in my heart, and I'm battling with that because there's bad in me as well. And you might think that's pretty bleak, and it might sort of sound like we're going with Ultron, you know? The human race is messed up, we're dark, we're evil. And you might think, well, if you think like that, you're going to end up agreeing with Ultron, and you're going to say, wipe them out, you know? But actually, that's not why the Bible tells us about darkness. It's not trying to kind of, it's not saying, and that's it. But what it's trying to do is to get us to be honest and just admit, you know, and recognize the fact that actually there is this darkness. And the truth of the matter is, if we never get that, we'll never understand the light. If you don't understand the darkness, you never understand the light. And it's sort of true in life, isn't it? I don't know about you, but in our house, lots of us love Christmas lights. We don't do very well ourselves, you know, like on the house and stuff. We're not very organized, that's the main problem. We've sort of made a bit of an effort. But what we found is the far better thing is to go and look at other people's houses. Do you ever do that? And round here, if you want to look at Christmas lights, I'd say the best place to go is Chirk Farm Estate over towards Lee. Okay, if you haven't been, I recommend you go. I don't know what they do over there. I think when you buy a house there, before you move in, they check that you've got like a big crate of Christmas lights. And if you don't have it, you're not allowed to move in. That's my theory. And so sometimes we go on trips to Chirk Farm just to see what they've done this year, you know. And it's amazing. It's brilliant. But the thing is, if you're going to look at Christmas lights, when do you go? Well, you can go whenever you like, but you're not going to go in daytime, are you? You're not going to go in the middle of, you're not going to go at lunchtime. That'd be a terrible time to look at Christmas lights. You go when it's dark, don't you? That's the time to go, because when it's dark, you can see them, they stand out. And you know, that's true with us. You know, if we shut out the idea, if we pretend there isn't darkness in our kind of lives and in humanity, if we try to pretend that we're all right, really, the thing is, if we do that, we'll never see the light, which is the second thing about Christmas. The big thing about Christmas is the light, but you've got to recognize the darkness to see the light. Do you get that? So let's do that. Let's have a look at the light. And the light is, what is the light? And the light is the one who was born. So from that verse, the one that Paul read at the end, in the middle of that, it said, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And that's talking about Jesus. It's talking about the person person who came. And of course, he comes as a baby. And I think sometimes we think, oh, well, of course it's light, you know, because babies are great, aren't they? And you know, and I'm sure a lot of us love babies. Babies are, you know, they're cute and they're sort of tiny little fingers, all that kind of thing. Who doesn't? Well, some people may not be keen on babies, but loads of us, we love them, don't you? Especially, actually, if it's not your baby. That's what I find, because what you do, you hold the baby, and then everything's great, and then you start sniffing, and you think, hold on a minute, something's happened here, and then you can just hand it back. That's great, isn't it? But the point of Christmas is it's not light because he's a baby, because that's to miss the point. The reason it's light is because this baby is a person who is different, who's truly different. And he hasn't got the darkness problem. That's the thing, you see? He's light. And the claim that's made about Jesus in the Bible, and if it isn't that, it's not even worth listening to. But the claim is that this person is different, that he is God. God somehow, in some amazing way, has become a human being. The one who made us has become part of what he made in some amazing way. And he doesn't have the problem we have. His heart is not fractured down the middle, like that guy Solzhenitsyn said. His wasn't like that. And he was different. And because he lived a life like we were meant to live, he lived what we were supposed to be, his whole life was light. But the thing is, and the thing is, it's not just that he came into the world, it's like a light was in the world for a time. The whole point is that what he then did was, because he lived a perfect life, because his life was completely light, when he died, which he did very deliberately and for a reason and voluntarily, he did it to pay our debt. He didn't have a debt of his own. He hadn't done wrong things himself. So his death did something for us. And it made it possible for our debt to be cleared, our wrong and the darkness that means God turns away from us. He forgives us for that because of what Jesus did, because Jesus paid our debt. And that's what it means when it says, you know, that he gives light. It's not just that we look at Jesus and say, oh, what an amazing person. It's that through what he did in dying for us, he cleans us of all the darkness. And that doesn't mean we suddenly become better. But what it means is we're forgiven for the stuff we do. And we know that with God, we're sorted. So this is the thing about the Christmas message. In some ways, it's bleak. You know, in many ways, it sounds like Ultron's idea. You know, humanity is you know, has messed up. And you might think that's where it's going to go. If you read the Bible and you only read those bits about the darkness, you'd say, well, you know, we're in trouble. And you know, of course, that's got to be the end of it. But although the Christmas message on one hand is very bleak, on the other hand, it's got an answer to that. It doesn't sort of try and, what we do is we try and say, oh, I don't think it's that bad. You know, as long as I do my best, I'll be all right. But actually the Bible says, no, you know, it's really bad. But Jesus has come. He's the light to shine some true light into our lives and to make it possible for us to be sorted with God. And Jesus coming to the world was God coming to the world to blast light into our lives if we're willing to accept it. So the Christmas message is, it is bad, it is black, it's dark, but into that darkness steps the light. And if we're willing to kind of accept this dark stuff and the difficulty of that, actually then we're ready to accept and trust this one who was different to any other person who's ever walked the earth, and who did something for us so that our darkness might be taken away. And I think that's a wonderful message, although it comes with a kind of a, you know, difficulty to it as we come to grips with what it's saying, but we think it's a brilliant message. And we'd love to help anybody who wants to find out more about it. And we're running a course. On your tables, there's some of these cards. And we're running a course called Hope Explored. Now, we've got some dates for one running of it. All it is three, you get together three times for an hour, so over 3 weeks. And we're running it on Thursday daytimes at 11:45 a.m. on the 6th, the 13th, and 20th of Jan. But we're going to run it at other times as well, if that's no good for anyone who wants to do it. But we're definitely running it on those dates. So if you're interested, take one of those. And if you'd like to sign up for that, or if you say, well, I can't do those dates, but I'd love to do it, then talk to someone you know from the church and let us know. Or there's an email address on there. That comes to me. I pick that up. So do send us a message as well. That'd be great. And we'd love to. It's easy going. You can ask your questions, you can listen, and you can walk away. You know, it's great. But it's an opportunity just to find out a bit more about this person who claimed to be the light of the world. So that'd be great. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to pray, which is a bit of an odd thing, but it seems odd perhaps. But we're going to speak to God. I'm going to speak to God for all of us, and just ask him to help us with these things. And then after that, we've got one more carol, which is, I think in the music group, it's a lot of people's favourite, so we're going to sing that. And then as we're just finishing, there's some other music we're going to play. But if you want to get there might be some more drinks available, so you can grab a drink. And if the mince pies aren't all gone, that's, you know, go for it. But okay, I'm going to pray. Dear God, we thank you for this message, which is kind of hard, but also it's amazing. And if it's true that you really have stepped into our world in Jesus and have come so that you could do something for us to change our lives, then that is incredible. And dear God, we just pray you'd help us to find out about that if we don't know much about it already, and think about it and consider what is going on in this life? What is life all about? Help us to ask those deep questions and have a look and see at what you are claiming, what the Bible claims you have done. And we just pray you'd help us to discover new things about what you've done. And we just want to thank you for this amazing message and thank you that you care so much for us that you actually entered our world with all its craziness and all its messed upness, and yet you were prepared to come into it to do something about the darkness. And we just thank you for that. Amen. Okay, one more carol. And then just something to listen to after that.
Joy to the world that God has come. Let us rejoice. unfaithful, come. Weak and unstable, come. No, you are not alone. Oh, come, barren and waiting ones, weary of praying, come. See what your God has done. Christ is born. Christ is born. Christ is born for you. Oh, come, bitter and broken, come, with fears unspoken, come, taste of his perfect love. Oh, come, guilty and hiding ones, there is no need to run, see what your God has done. Christ is born, Christ is born, Christ is born for you. He's the Lamb who was given, slain for our pardon. His you have nothing, come. He is the offering, come. See what your God has done. Christ is born. Christ is born.
He's born for